first reading for the third Sunday of Easter is from Acts chapter 3. While the lame man who was now healed clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's, astounded. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, and the God of our fathers glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate, when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One, and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third definition of being overwhelmed is to be buried beneath a huge mass. Buried beneath a huge mass. To be defeated completely. To be given too much of a thing that you can't handle it. That's the idea. There is an impossibility to manage the thing when you're overwhelmed. You can't control it. You are succumbed to it. Have you ever had a dream where you were overwhelmed? I have one every once in a while where somebody's chasing me and my legs don't work. They're not moving. Have you ever had something like that? And you become overwhelmed with the dream and you wake up and you're glad you woke up? Being overwhelmed has to do with that. You're out of control. Now, in both cases, whether you're overwhelmed with fear or overwhelmed with joy, there's a sense of not being able to accept it. Okay? It's kind of like this, I see it, but it's kind of too bad to be true or too good to be true. And then there's this disbelief that is attached to it. And I think if we all step back and think about it, we are in a constant state of being overwhelmed, even though we don't always think so. Because normally we get up on a day and we go do our work, we do our responsibility, and there's a lot of mundaneness to life, but really, you're always worried about what overwhelms you. Because bad things happen, and you think about bad things happening. At the same time, good things can happen too. Okay? Let me give you an example. We just had our grandson Lincoln, Brian Stepper, born just a little while ago. Now, I experienced that, not to the degree of the disciples, but I experienced it nonetheless. Because there was a scheduled C-section for the 23rd of April for Brian and Raven's baby. The baby was breached, just like the first one. So they scheduled it for the 23rd. Well, Carl and I get a text from Brian on April 5th. Baby is coming today. And that's how he put it. All right? And so, what do you think? Well, it's scheduled on the 23rd. This is now a premature baby. What's the thought? I'm now overwhelmed with what? A fear of what's going on. What's the complication? He then proceeds to tell me. But, and then I was also overwhelmed with joy. I'm going to have another grandchild be born. And I experienced those at the same time. You ever had that kind of experience? You might have had an experience where you were overwhelmed because of a tragedy. Someone dies unexpectedly. Someone gets a disease. You get a disease unexpectedly. Something happens. Or there's also the overwhelmment when, let's say, I can always remember when the Vietnam veterans came home. Not the first ones, but the POWs. I still have that in my mind where they're coming off the plane and they're meeting with their wives or their mothers and the overwhelming amount of joy that would happen. Or the surprise one where you have a soldier coming home and the wife doesn't realize it and they film it and he taps her on the shoulder. She turns around and then had no idea. And what? She is what? Overwhelmed with joy. See, that's what's happening. Now, I would suggest most of our lives, even though they're mundane and predictable, we live in overwhelmingness. We do. For sure, we get overwhelmed with our fears. We all get overwhelmed with our fears because we say, what might happen? Because here's the second thing that happened to me. We went over to New Hampshire right after we found the baby. And after a couple days, I was able to hold little Lincoln. He was 5 pounds. He was fine. Then when I was holding that fragile, dependent baby, and I began to think about his future, right? And I could not help but be overwhelmed with fear. What's going to happen to this boy in this sin-filled world? What can happen? And you begin to think. And there's all kinds of things that could happen. And I became overwhelmed with fear and all the what ifs. And at the same time, I'm looking at the child and I said, this child was purposed by God. God knew that he would be born from eternity just like the rest of us. So God wills this life. life to be, and lo and behold, he is. And from eternity, God knew Lincoln would be. And then there was this overwhelming what? Joy. Then the question is, well, what wins out? My overwhelmment of fear for the child? Or when I come and visit the overwhelming of joy, knowing that God purposed this and there is a will attached to God. And what do we say? God's will, thy will be what? Done, and it is. Most of our daily lives are mundane, predictable. We get up, we do our thing, but we're overwhelmed by fear. My question is, how often are we overwhelmed by joy? And then why don't I ask myself the question, why wouldn't God's resolve in creating us and redeeming us be what overwhelms us more often than it does? Since his resolve is permanent, and my fears are temporary and for the moment. Both my worry about them, and then when I have to go through them, and their implications, even when they come true. See? The disciples in our text today are overwhelmed by fear and joy to the max. It's the evening of that first day. Earlier, there was an empty tomb. And the disciples heard from the women, "We saw him." And then, if you read just before this text, you'll find that the two guys on the road to Emmaus also saw him, and they came to tell the disciples they too saw the resurrected Christ. So there's this serious buzz going around, and I don't see it in the text anywhere where the disciples say, "Hey, he's probably going to come visit us too. We're his disciples." That doesn't happen. You go to John's gospel and the doors are locked. So they're still in fear. But they get the news from the women and the two on the road to Emmaus. You go to Mark's gospel and they're having dinner when all of this happens. And it says now in the text, while they were still talking about this, Jesus stood among them and said to them, "You blockheads."
No.
"Peter, why did you deny me?"
No.
"Why are you guys all in locked doors? Don't you remember?"
No.
What's the first words he says? "Peace. My peace be with you." Just like when he said in the Gospel of John, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives." And no. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not. Do not be afraid. This is a heartfelt absolution by Jesus. In those days, they would say, "Peace be with you." And it's kind of like when I would say to you, "Have a good day." And you say to me, "Have a good day," right? You know, it's a hopeful, you hope that somebody has, no. This is a declaration. "My peace be with you. I forgive you." And the disciples, what do they do? It's a ghost. They can't make out. They are overwhelmed with what? Fear in the midst of an absolution. They're overwhelmed with fear. Because bodies don't walk through walls and we have the doors locked. And therefore, this can't be happening. This can't be a body. It must be a spirit because we see something, right? And in those days, if you see a ghost, you're dead. So they're an absolute. Bottom line, it's too fantastic. It's too fantastic. two things in life are certain. Two things in life are certain. The tragedies and death that I fear, and God's provision of resurrection from those tragedies that I fear and sometimes meet me. Those two things are happening. I'm overwhelmed by that one. Am I overwhelmed by God's provision of resurrection from my tragedies and his declaration to you that resurrection is certain for his children? Now I have to ask myself the question today, in this day, regardless of what troubles I have right now and how overwhelmed I am, which one is going to overwhelm me in the end? And which one is going to overwhelm me today? Tomorrow? The next day, in the midst of all of my fears and tragedy of fears and all that stuff. Therefore, what does faith ultimately do? Overwhelms us with joy, even and maybe especially in the trenches of life, with all of the fears that overwhelm us, where you can't handle it. See? It's a ghost! What does Jesus do next? I'm not a ghost. He is very intent on telling them, I'm not just the Spirit, I am the incarnate Christ. Now, this is something we all have to understand, because I could ask this group right here, and I'll bet half of you won't get it right. Does Jesus have a body right now? The answer is yes. Half of you probably think, no. No, the point is what? Jesus is the resurrector. He is human forever. He is God in human forever, and that's how he relates to us. That's what the sacrament is all about. When we talk about the real presence of Christ, he's there, in with hiding in it, but he's there. And it's a foretaste of us going to have him forever, the physical Christ. It's all of him. And what does he say? He says to the disciples, first of all, I want you to look at me, then I want you to touch me, and now I want you to watch me eat fish. To guarantee to them he's not a ghost, but he is who he is, the incarnate Christ, fully God, fully man. And that's how we relate to God, through the person of Jesus Christ. That's why the sacrament of the altar is so important. That's where I get Christ in his incarnate fullness, when he forgives me. That's where I get my hug from Jesus, his physicality. My favorite verse in this whole thing is, while they still did not believe, why? Because of joy and amazement. See, that's being overwhelmed with what? Joy. It's this. I can't believe it. No. Look. You say, no, it can't be. Have you ever been there? You've been there. What I'm seeing, I can't believe it. That's what's going on here. Very peculiar verse. It's not that they didn't believe. It's that their common sense told them they better leave room for the possibility that it really isn't happening as they see it and experience it. And what they observe has to catch up with their common sense. You have experienced it, though not to this degree. You haven't seen them yet. One of my commentators that I read said, the heart is too small to take in the great joy all at once. Dear Christian, behold the resurrected Christ in bodily form, and each other in resurrected bodily form. That's how it's going to be forever. Involved in a feast that lasts forever. This is what we have to look forward to. This is what we have right now. It's overwhelming. Will it overwhelm you today? This is why we can welcome death when it comes. This is why we can actually welcome the tragedy, knowing what we know. This is why it says, where, O death?